I've used Blender occasionally in projects, but I always felt like I wasn't really unlocking its full potential. Most of the time it was just a side tool, but with Blender 4.5, introducing Vulkan, I knew I had to give a proper test. My name is Marlon, and I'm a digital artist with years of experience creating characters and creatures for VFX and games. And I like to push in tools to see what they are really capable of. So I decided to bring in this alien form from Zbrush and run it fully in Blender 4.5 with Vulkan. And this is what I found. By the way, if you're into sci-fi and space like me, you want to take a look to the Dwarf 3 Smart Telescope. I took it last weekend for a test, and honestly, it's just as simple as just plug and play. You just sync it to your own phone, pick what you want to observe, and the telescope does the rest. It automatically calibrates, aligns, and starts taking pictures for you. After just a couple of hours, I managed to capture this incredible shot of the C20 Nebula, all with the Dwarf 3 and my own phone. It's combat smart and perfect for anyone curious about exploration. If you are new to Blender, the very first thing that you need to do is to activate Vulkan. To do this, go to File, then Preferences, then System. Under Display Graphics, select Vulkan. Once you activate it, Blender will automatically prompt you to restart, so you just go ahead and restart the software. After Blender launches again, I import the alien in FBX format. When you enable viewport shading, just on the top right, you can instantly see how the light's been interacting with your character and your own scene. Now it's time to set up the HDRI. In the shading workspace, switch over to the world. And from there you can load your image texture. In this case, I'm loading an HDRI image. Make sure that the viewport shading is activated in the top right, otherwise the HDR won't appear in the viewport. To get more control over your HDRI, you want to add two extra nodes. The first is a texture coordinate, which lets you HDRI read UV coordinates properly. The second one is the mapping mode, which gives you full control over positioning. If you focus on the rotation values, you can rotate the HDRI however you want. Most of the time, you'll be rotating on the Z axis to move the lights into the right spot. You can also adjust the strength value to change how bright the HDRI looks in the viewport. All right, so now it's time to add the displacement to this alien. The first step is creating a subdivision surface modifier. So just get into the modifier menu and look for it. This is very important because it lets you control the subdivision levels separately for the viewport and for the final render. Once that's in place, we can add a displace modifier. Here, make sure that you load your displacement textures. And if you are working with UDIMs, enable them. I wanted to use UDIMs since they hold much more resolution, which is especially useful for close-up shots. Back in the modifier settings, set the mid-level to 0 and change the coordinates to UVs. This part was a bit tricky since most of the software defaults to UVs. So at first I couldn't figure out why the displacement wasn't working properly until I switched that setting. With the correct setup, the displacement finally appeared. Now I could see the results. But because I didn't want to push subdivisions higher than level 2, I decided to enhance the surface detail by combining it with a normal map and adjusting the strength values. This gave me more control over the overall details of the character, keeping it sharp and believable without overloading the mesh with unnecessary subdivisions. At this point, I also wanted to bring all the textures I had created in Mari. If you want to see the complete painting process for this alien, I have a full breakdown of the Mari workflow available inside my own memberships. Inside Blender, I connected the diffuse, the roughness, specular, and normal maps to the shaders, and the model immediately started to come alive. At this stage, I decided to do my first test render in Eve. My reasoning was pretty simple. Eve should be better for real-time performance, whether Cycles tends to be slower since it relies on RTX and heavier calculations. So while working on Eve, I start playing around with subsurface scattering and shader tweaks. But one thing that I noticed quickly is that I wasn't getting the result that I was looking for. I start to focus in mostly on the subsurface scattering. By default, the subsurface scale was set to 0.1, but I realized that I need a much lower value, something around 0.01 gave me better results. From there, I continue experimenting with other important parameters, especially the radius. The radius is critical since it controls how the scattering behaves through the surface. You need to think about how the skin is refracting red light from the underneath, so I like to treat the radius more like an RGB control. At this stage, I started to spread in texture information across the rest of the character. Because I had painted everything in UDIMs, the teeth and the tongue could reuse the same texture inputs. I simply copy the skin texture and paste them into the shaders from those areas. So right now, I'm going to switch to Cycles, just to see how it looks. And to my surprise, right away the render was giving me the correct shapes and some very interesting subsurface effects. One important step here is to activate the noise threshold in both the renders and also the viewport. And I wanted to show you this in real time because of how fast the render was behaving in the viewport. Keep in mind we're talking about real-time rendering with subdivisions enabled and a displacement modifier already applied and still getting detailed results instantly. At that moment, I thought, man, this is the fastest displacement setup I ever worked in my entire career. Normally, displacement takes a long time to process when it's turned on, but here it was just immediate. And even with the noise threshold activated, no detail was lost, especially on the speculars, which is where I wanted to focus the most. Since this is an alien, I also decided to tweak the code values. If you want to push your specular information even further, I recommend you to adjust your code weight and also the roughness. It helps you to create extra variation without the need to add noise maps or anything very complex. In Cycles, the subsurface also behaved much better than Eve. This led me to focus on the real values during the LookDev stage. From here, the process became more creative and way more fun. I adjusted the diffuse areas, refined how the colors were blending, and began to plan the camera setup. All right, so now let's focus on the final frame. For the camera, make sure that you go in the options under view, and make sure that you lock the camera to the viewport. This way, when you press 0 on your keyboard, you can navigate inside the viewport as if you were just looking through the camera directly. And this is a very important step because it lets you to frame your shots while still working interactively. I noticed that using a high focal length gave me a much better sense of the character. I also enabled the save frame guide so I could stay focused only on the composition. With the camera locked and adjusted, I could finally start thinking about how I wanted to present the alien. Another important step was disabling overlays. You have to remember that we are working real time. So under viewport overlays, I turned off the floor and also the axis guides. So I had a complete clean shot. Just the character with subdivisions and displacements visible in real time. With the camera set up, it was time to go back and refine the lighting. I returned to the world settings and tested different HDRIs to see how they would affect the mood. Along the way, I added brightness, contrast, and hue saturation notes to the areas like the teeth, the tongue, so I could push the look also even further. And this is where the artist's vision really comes into play. The way you present a character can completely transform how it's perceived. Lighting and shading aren't just technical steps, they are storytelling tools. By experimenting with different intensities, color, or angles, you can shift the mood from something neutral to something truly dramatic. It often takes a lot of trial and error, but finding that perfect balance is what gives the works its final impact. So at this stage, the character looks solid, but also a little too static. I'm going to give you one trick. To give it more life, I went back to Zbrush and created slime using the slime bridge. This tool is great. You just mask two parts of a mesh, and with a few parameters like tension, bridge, and branches, it generates slimy connective tissues. By tweaking these values, you can control how thick or stretched the slime looks, where it feels more like sticky saliva or a heavy dripping go. Adding this kind of element not only makes the model look more alive, but also pushes the presentation into something more visceral and unsettling. Exactly what I wanted for this alien form. I imported the slime mesh back into Blender, and in the shading editor, I set the transmission values close to 1, and lowered the roughness to near 0. That gave it the translucent glossy effect I was looking for. With those adjustments, the character finally started to feel alive. Grotesque, but alive, which was exactly my goal. After that, I spent the next 10 minutes fully focused on the look dev, carefully adjusting each shader of the alien. This stage is all about refinement, tweaking roughness, balancing the specular response, and making sure that the subsurface scattering feels naturally across different areas of the model. It's a slow, iterative process, but refinement is key. Every small adjustment adds up, and those subtle changes are what takes the character from just looking decent to feel believable and alive. The next step was to set up a camera rotation around the alien. To do this, I created a locator and positioned it right on the alien's eyes, so the pivot would stay centered on its face. Then I duplicated my current camera and parented to the locator. The process is pretty simple. First, just select the camera. Then select the locator and press Ctrl P and choosing object. Once that's done, the setup is complete. Now, whenever you rotate the locator, the camera will automatically follow, orbiting perfectly around the character. It's a very simple and effective setup, basically how you create a turntable in Blender or any other software. Now we're moving into the animation itself. Creating an animation in Blender is actually quite straightforward. First, make sure that you set the correct frame range on the timeline. Then activate auto keyframe, so Blender will automatically record my changes. With that enabled, I create the keyframes of both the start and the end of the animation. One important detail is to switch the curves to linear mode. This way the animation plays at constant speed without that strange acceleration or slows down. With everything set up, the rotation looked good, but I quickly noticed a problem. By the end of the sequence, the alien was drifting out of the frame. So I needed to fix that. At first it looked like a small issue, but if you ever work on a character's turntables, you know that framing is everything. If the subject drifts out of the view, the whole presentation feels broken. The good thing is that the solution turned out to be quite simple once I thought it through. The first thing I did was switching to shading mode, which allowed me to see the shot exactly as it would appear in the final render. At frame 0, I framed the camera transformations. Did lock the starting shot exactly where I wanted to be. Then I jumped back into the viewport mode and began adjusting the camera local value by nudging it slightly from its original placement. I was able to reframe the alien so that by the end of the rotation, more of the character stayed visible within the shot. It gave me much better, cleaner, and more professional result. But this introduced a new problem. Because the camera was no longer in its original position, the depth of field started to feel off. To fix it, I jumped back into the camera settings, enabled depth of field, and set the focus to the original locator. By doing this, the camera always stayed locked on the alien's eyes. It was a very cool trick because no matter how I move or adjust the camera, the focus remained exactly where it needed to be. First, make sure you choose the right file format. In this case, PNG or TIFF works perfectly. Then select your output path. For compression, I like to set it to none, so I keep the best quality. Double check your frame start and end, and as well as the frame rate and format, so everything matches correctly. I also prefer disabling all metadata since I don't want any extra information stamping to the final render. With the settings in place, go to Render, Render Animation, and Blender will generate your image sequence. Now, here is something actually pretty cool that I was not aware of that. Blender also has a built-in video editor. To use it, create a new scene and select video editing. Once inside, you can load your image sequence. Just press Shift A and select your sequence and they'll be imported. But before importing, make sure that they are sorted by name, so they come in the right order. In my case, I render everything in PNG with transparency enabled because I wasn't sure what kind of background I actually wanted. Inside the video editor, I created a solid color track as a background. I tested different values until I found a dark blue tone that gave the character a better atmosphere. Without it, the scene looked a little bit flat against the pure black background. What surprised me is how easy this part of the workflow was. I honestly didn't know Blender has such a capable video editor built right in. And once the tiling was organized, I went back to the output settings to finalize the render. This time, instead of a PNGs, I switched the format to FFmpeg video. Under encoding, select the MPEG-4 with the codec of H.264 and push the quality settings as high as possible. Since my video had no audio, I set the audio to none in this case. With everything ready, I hit just render animation again and Blender output the final video extremely fast, just like that. I had my finished sequence ready to go. I have to say, I was genuinely amazed by how fast Vulkan felt when paired with Cycles. Even with displacement and subdivisions active, the viewport stayed quite responsive and enabling the noise didn't slow things down at all. For me, this is the smoothest Blender has ever felt. So if you already tried Vulkan in Blender 4.5, let me know your experience in the comments. I would love to hear how it's working for you. Until then, just happy sculpting and I see you in the next video.